Hello everyone and welcome back. So in today's video we shall take up a new topic, that is alternatives to animal models for toxicological testing. Okay, so in the earlier lectures we have covered the in vivo acute, subacute and chronic toxicity testing. But as per the regulations, to satisfy the regulations, as we have seen that the number of animals which are required or the number of parameters which are supposed to be studied, these may be vast. So in order to reduce the number of animals, or rather to eradicate the use of animals, certain alternatives have been developed to the animal models for carrying out such toxicological testing. So we shall cover all these alternatives which are developed recently. Okay, so before going into the actual toxicity testing which can be carried out in vitro, we shall have a brief discussion over how these particular concepts of alternatives develop. Okay, so usually certain legislative authorities, scientific or legislative authorities and animal rights activists throughout the world, these agencies are demanding the abolition of the animal experimentation, because we have seen, especially in several toxicity testing, you are inducing certain untoward effects in that particular animal, right? You are exposing that particular animal to a toxic substance. Okay, to find out the potential dangers or the potential adverse effects that particular chemical might produce, to estimate the safety of that particular chemical which is supposed to be introduced in the commerce, which might be handled by the humans or will be exposed to the humans. So in order to estimate the potential risk, we actually carry out the animal experimentation before that particular chemical is introduced into commerce. But these social activists, they are working towards total abolition of the animal experimentation which is done. So as a result of this, there have been development of certain alternative tests. Most of these are the in vitro tests, certain are in silico tests. Okay, so certain computerized models have also been developed which are growing nowadays. Okay, their popularity is increased because the use of animals is getting decreased. Okay, so number of animals also is getting decreased, and more than that, the pain and the stress which is induced by these toxicity testing, these can be minimized by finding such alternative methods for the toxicity testing. But according to Philip Buskin, an European research commissioner, it is unfortunately necessary to use the animals in order to safeguard the human health. Okay, there are certain situations, no doubt, alternatives are important to be utilized. Okay, because unnecessarily, just to safeguard the human health, you can't induce the toxic effects in the animals. Okay, it's not ethically correct. But unfortunately, there are certain situations in which it is an unavoidable situation. That means you have to use the animals. Okay? But for that matter, what you can do is at least reduce the number of animals, or at least reduce the amount of stress and the amount of adverse effects which are introduced in these particular animals. to reduce the potential toxicity or terminal toxicity in such animals. Okay, so for that matter, in order to maintain these balance, now you have to find the alternatives plus you have to use the animals. In certain situations it is unavoidable. So to balance this particular situation, Russell and Birch in 1959, they developed a concept of three R's. In order to minimize the use of animals, okay, or at least to minimize the inhumanity towards the animals. Okay, so they developed this particular concept with respect to the use of animals. Okay, so three R's you all must be aware of. This is an environmental concern also. Okay, refinement, reduction and replacement. Okay, so these are the three R's which will ensure the reduction in the usage of the animals, okay, and the inhumanity which might be done towards the animals. So this will also ensure the finding of or development of the alternative studies to the use of the animal experimentation. Okay, so before going into the actual alternative test towards the toxicity studies, we shall see how we can reduce the use of animals with this particular concept. Okay, the first one is refinement. Refinement means to minimize the incidence or severity of inhumane procedures. Because in certain cases you have seen that the animals, these are introduced with severe toxicity. In certain cases the organs of the animals might get permanently damaged. Or at the end, you might have to sacrifice the animal. So to avoid this particular inhumanity, you can design your studies accordingly. Okay, you can make the modifications of the procedure that will decrease the potential pain or distress, or even use the animals of which are lower in phylogenetic category. Okay, so such kind of modifications might be done which will produce no doubt appropriate results, and plus it will help in decreasing the inhumanity towards the experimental animals. Now there are certain examples which are quoted over here. So when you carry out certain diagnostic procedures, okay, or to investigate certain presence of certain internal damage, you can utilize non-invasive monitoring such as MRI study can be done on the animals, or implantable monitoring devices such as recording of the BP. So you can keep the implant so that it will induce minimum stress to the animal, because continuous recording of the animal which is placed in a restrainer, it might introduce the stress in that animal. So in order to avoid that, implants can be introduced. Okay, nowadays so many implants are available. So monitoring devices in the form of implants, these are placed beneath the skin and you can continuously monitor the BP. Okay, then you should as far as possible go for the humane endpoints, wherein minimization of the inhumanity towards the animal is possible. Then next parameter under 3 R's is reduction. Okay, that is the reduction in the number of animals which are supposed to be used in the experiment. Okay, so in olden days a large number of animals were being utilized. Okay, say for example in case of vaccine quality control, a large number of animals were required to ensure the vaccine quality control. Okay, so by following this particular principles, okay, 3 R's, that is reduction, you can significantly reduce the number of animals which are required to be utilized. So the next parameter under the 3 R's is replacement. That is substitution of insentient material. insentient in the sense something which does not have any feeling, rather than using conscious higher animals. Okay, so wherever possible, when non-animal methods are available, it is wise to avoid the experiments in the animals. Okay, so they should not be performed in the animals when non-animal models are available. And now this replacement may be relative, okay, in the sense the situations in which it is not possible to avoid the use of animals completely. Like say for examples, even though you are performing the experiments in vitro, that is by utilizing certain tissues or organs, yet you need to use the animals, right? Because the source of these tissues and organs, ultimately it is the animals. Okay, so as far as possible, you can replace the animals by either isolating certain organs, okay, or maybe you can utilize the cell lines which are obtained from certain animals. Okay, so you can purchase these cell lines and perform the studies on the cell lines also. So this will also help in replacement of the animal with the other sources which are available. Okay, now with this brief introduction to the 3 R's, in view of reducing the number of animals, okay, there are several alternative non-animal tests which have been developed. Okay, so we will cover all of these alternative non-animal tests in detail. Okay, so what are the basis and how exactly these particular tests are carried out. Okay, so these are some of the alternative non-animal tests, okay, wherein whole animal is not required, but mostly these are the in vitro tests or the tests which are done on the cell lines and so on. Okay, so the alternative methods are as follows: in vitro pyrogen test, then the embryonic stem cell test, EST it is known as, local lymph node assay, that is also known as LLNA, this is the accepted short form for the skin sensitization. Next alternative method is clinical skin patch test on human volunteers. So here, rather than using the animals, the studies are carried out on the human volunteers. Next method is the neutral red uptake, NRUSA. Then there are certain alternative methods to carry out carcinogenicity tests also in vitro. Then acute toxicity tests, as we have seen, in vivo tests are available. So likewise, alternative methods are also available wherein you can reduce the number of animals and sometimes completely replace the use of animals. Okay, part. Then next method is the repeated dose toxicity test. Okay, so we have seen that certain tests are carried out over a period of time, subacute or chronic toxicity tests. These are done for an appreciable period of time, and repeated dosing is given in the same animal. So such kind of tests also, alternatives are available. And the last one is developmental neurotoxicity test, DNT. Okay, so during the fetal development, what are the chances of toxicity? So how can you study this without using the animals? So such in vitro tests are also available. So we will discuss all of these in detail. So we'll take up first one, that is in vitro pyrogen test. Okay, so this is an alternative which was developed towards the use of rabbits for pyrogen testing. In the earlier days, pyrogen test in the rabbits was quite common, but nowadays a number of such alternatives are available to the rabbit pyrogen test. That is, two of the quite commonly utilized methods are LAL test, this is quite famous. that is limulus amebocyte lysate test or monocyte activation test, MAT. Okay, so these are the two quite commonly used alternative tests for the in vivo pyrogen testing in the rabbits. Okay, now in these particular in vitro pyrogen tests, the main basis of this particular test is response of the human leukocyte, mainly the monocytes. As a result of release of the inflammatory mediators. Okay. Now, when these inflammatory mediators will be released? Whenever there is a exposure to an exogenous pyrogen, that is pyrogenic contamination, external contamination or exposure takes place. At that time, what will happen? There will be release of endogenous pyrogens, that is certain inflammatory mediators will be released in response to these external source of pyrogenic substances. And as a result of this, the human cells will start responding towards these particular released inflammatory mediators. Okay, so this is mainly the basis for this these particular in vitro pyrogen tests. Now coming to the first one, that is limulus amebocyte lysate test or LAL test. Now this particular LAL test, it is based upon the extracellular coagulation of the blood, okay, that is hemolymph, okay, which is caused by the lipopolysaccharides, LPS, which is popularly known as. Now this particular coagulation of blood is induced in the horseshoe crab, Limulus polyphemus. So this is the horseshoe crab which is utilized, in which actually the testing is done. Due to the release of this lipopolysaccharides, it causes the extracellular coagulation of the blood. Okay, so this is the main principle behind this particular test. Now there are certain advantages and disadvantages with this particular test. Okay, it is compared to the rabbit pyrogen test, it is more sensitive. But the disadvantages are sometimes false negative results may also be obtained by the use of certain products, okay, or sometimes overestimation of the pyrogen content may also be produced, okay. One more disadvantage is that it does not detect the pyrogens which are other than the bacterial endotoxins, okay, such as from the gram positive bacteria or the viruses or the fungi. So it is limited towards such kind of pyrogens. Okay, so that's a limitation of the test. Coming to the next type of in vitro pyrogen test, that is the monocyte activation test, MAT. So this particular test, it uses the human mononuclear cells, that is monocytes. Okay, so these monocytes, they can be obtained from the human volunteers or from the blood bank also it can be made available. Okay, so here in this particular test, pro-inflammatory and pyrogenic contaminants can be detected, okay, which might not be even be detected by the rabbit pyrogen test or the LAL test. Okay, so that's the advantage of this particular test. Then the second type of alternative test is the embryonic stem cell test, EST. Okay, so this is mainly meant for detection of the embryonic toxicity. Okay, so for this matter, okay, embryonic stem cells are utilized, which are spontaneously developed into the contracting myocardium. Okay, now the end points of this particular test. Okay, so what are those parameters which you will be observing for? Okay, so the endpoints of this particular test are inhibition of differentiation of the embryonic stem cells. Okay, ES is the embryonic stem cells into the cardiomyocytes. Okay, so this differentiation can be inhibited by the toxin, so that you can watch out for, or cytotoxic effects on the embryonic stem cells. Okay, that is certain substances may be toxic to the embryonic stem cells so that these cells get killed, or cytotoxic effects on the 3T3 fibroblast. Okay, so these are certain cell lines which are obtained from the albino mice. Okay, so this could be the endpoints of embryonic stem cell test. Now in this particular test, what exactly are you evaluating? Okay, so in this test, the capacity of the stem cells to develop into the specialized contracting heart cells in vitro, these are basically studied. Okay, so within a period of 10 days, whether these particular stem cells are able to differentiate into specialized contracting heart cells. Okay, so what are the potential embryotoxic effects on this particular development? So this is the parameter which is studied in this particular test. Okay, whether that differentiation, that is development into the heart cells from the stem cells, this is basically studied, whether it is getting affected. Now, apart from this, metabolism studies can also be carried out by using human microsomal enzymes or the cell lines. Okay, so usually you can study the metabolic changes which are taking place, that is whether a non-toxic substance is getting metabolized into a toxic one, or vice versa, that is from a toxic substance non-toxic chemical is getting formed as a result of metabolism. So such kind of studies can also be carried out in addition to this particular changes in the differentiation of the cells. Okay, so now here the positive result in this particular study, so it is regarded as sufficient to have an evidence on the embryo toxicity, to classify that a particular chemical can have embryo toxicity, whether it is hazardous to the development or the reproduction. So such parameters can be studied in this particular test. The next type of in vitro test is the local lymph node assay for skin sensitization. Okay, so we have seen that in the toxicity studies, animals are utilized for skin sensitization. So such type of test can also be performed. Okay, by having a observation on the lymph nodes wherever the substances apply. Okay, so the basis for this particular test is that the test compound, when it is applied to a particular area of the skin, it will result in lymph node draining in that particular area where it is applied. Okay, so as a result of this, what will happen? It will result in proliferation of the lymphocytes in that particular area. So this can be measured by radioactive labeling. So wherever it is applied to the skin, there will be proliferation of the lymphocytes. Okay, so the more the proliferation, it will indicate more is the sensitization. Okay, so proliferation, it will be proportional to the dose of the drug which is applied, or dose of that particular chemical which is applied. So you can quantify this particular sensitization test also. Okay, so once you quantify, you can even compare it, you can have a dose response relationship. Okay, and this particular proliferation of the lymphocytes, it can be even compared with the vehicle treated controls wherein only the vehicle is applied. Okay, and proliferation of the lymphocytes can be noted, and the two can be compared. Now the ratio of this proliferation of lymphocytes in the treated group to that which is produced in the vehicle control group, this ratio, it is denoted by this particular term, stimulation index. So it will give you a stimulation index. So more the stimulation index, more will be the sensitization capacity of that particular chemical. Okay, so it should have at least a score of 3. The simulation index should be at least 3 for it to be a potential skin sensitizer. Then the next alternative is the clinical skin patch test on human volunteers. Now here, this particular alternative test, you're using the human beings. Human volunteers are being utilized over here. Okay, so as the name implies, a patch is being applied over here. Now the greatest advantage with this particular test is that you are testing it in the human beings. Okay, so extrapolation from the animals to the human beings, that particular step is ruled out over here. Okay, so that's beneficial because here you are getting the data which is directly relevant to the human beings. Okay, so that's the advantage of this particular drug. But before carrying out this particular test, you should confirm that this particular substance is not corrosive by utilizing certain tests in which animals are not utilized. Certain non-animal in vitro tests are available to find out whether a particular substance is corrosive or irritating. Okay, so once you have the assurance that it is non-irritating, okay, and are negative in vitro mutagenicity studies, if you get negative results, so then and only then you can utilize this particular clinical patch test to confirm the non-irritancy in the human beings. So without being sure about the non-irritating property, okay, or non-corrosive property of this particular substance, you cannot apply it to the skin of the human beings. You should be sure about this non-corrosiveness by utilizing certain in vitro tests, and after that you can check it for the sensitization by applying it on the skin of human volunteers. Okay, so here this particular method, it is an alternative to the animal testing for the skin irritation or skin sensitization, which we have seen under the in vivo toxicity studies. Okay. Then the next alternative method is neutral red uptake, NRU-SA. Okay, so this particular assay, it is developed as an in vitro alternative towards the Dray's test. Okay, so we have already seen how Dray's test is exactly carried out. Okay, so this is mainly utilized for screening the eye irritation potential, wherein the substance under study is, it is instilled into the eye of the rabbits, right? So as an alternative to this, a number of normal human epidermal keratinocytes can be utilized, okay, or BLBC3T3 mouse fibroblast. Okay, this is an fibroblast which obtained from the albino mouse. Okay, or SIRC cells. Okay, certain cell lines which are obtained from the rabbit cornea. Okay, so certain cell lines can be utilized as an alternative towards the utilization of rabbits. Okay, rather than damaging the eyes of the animals, because we have seen that it is quite harmful and it can result in permanent blindness in the animals. So this particular test is, it is of major concern. A lot of study was being carried out to find out the alternatives to this particular test. So by utilizing certain cell lines, you can avoid the damage to the eye of an animal. Okay, now let us see what is the basis of this particular neutral red uptake assay. Okay, so here what are we measuring? We are measuring the ability of your test substance to inhibit the uptake of this particular dye, neutral red dye. Okay, so this is a marker for cell viability. Okay, only the intact cells will be able to take up this particular dye, neutral red dye. Okay, so it can penetrate the cell membranes and accumulate intracellularly in the lysosomes. Okay, so now in case of any kind of alteration of the cell surfaces or sensitive lysosomal membrane, it will result in the decreased uptake of this neutral red. So alterations in the uptake of this neutral red will take place. Normal cell will take up this particular dye and it will result in accumulation intracellularly. But in case if the cell membrane is damaged, it will result in decrease in the uptake. Okay, so what are those chances of inhibition of uptake of this particular neutral dye? This is what is studied in this particular assay. Okay, now for that matter, cell lines are generally utilized. Okay, or primary cell cultures can be utilized. Okay, now cell lines such as Chinese hamster, V79 or CHO, or 3T3 bulb C, and rabbit corneal cell lines. So these can be popularly utilized to carry out this particular NRU assay, wherein you are checking the uptake of this particular dye within the cells. Okay, so if the cell is able to take up the dye, it indicates the cell is normal and your chemical is not affecting that particular type of cell. Okay, now what you should usually look at, okay, generally just like your LD50, okay, or IC50, in this particular test also you are checking out for a concentration of your test substance which is able to produce 50% of inhibition of the neutral red uptake as compared to that of the control which does not contain your toxic substance. So likewise the comparison can be made. Okay, and you can calculate the NRU50, that is the dose at which or the amount of your substance at which 50% inhibition of this uptake of the dye is taking place. Okay, so this is considered as an endpoint in this particular test. And the next type of test is carcinogenicity test. Okay, so such type of tests also are carried out in vivo, but then inducing cancer in an animal, this is quite inhumane. Can it can be quite painful. Okay, so a lot of efforts have been taken to find out the alternatives for this particular type of studies. Okay, through the use of non-genotoxic mechanisms. Okay, so over here cell transformation assays are carried out. Okay, so commonly utilized assays include BALB/c 3T3 assay or Syrian hamster embryo SHE assay. So these are quite commonly utilized assays to carry out the carcinogenicity. Okay, now this particular test, these are quite reproducible, okay, the results which are obtained. Okay, so a high level predictivity is possible with these particular types of tests, especially this SHE assay. This is quite sensitive towards a wide range of both genotoxic as well as non-genotoxic carcinogens. We have seen, okay, genotoxicity, carcinogenicity in detail in the earlier lectures also, and a specific toxicity. So both type of carcinogens, okay, their sensitivity can be tested. The known carcinogens, 96% of the known human carcinogens could be detected by utilizing this particular test. Okay, then there are certain advantages of this particular assay in that it is faster, it takes only 6 weeks, and even it is less expensive as compared to the utilization of the transgenic mouse model or utilizing the animals for this particular study. Okay, when it is carried out in vivo, even fewer animals are involved over here. Okay, because a maximum of 8 embryos are required. Okay, as compared to 800 or even more than that, animals might be required when in vivo studies are carried out. So that's the advantage of this particular test. The next type of alternative is the acute toxicity test. Okay, alternatives to the acute toxicity test. Now here what is the basis for carrying out in vitro acute toxicity test? Now, the reason behind this is that though you are studying the acute toxicity of your substance in vivo, that is in an intact animal, basically the damage which takes place, it is at cellular level, right? Or the toxicity which takes place due to the action of your chemical or the substance, it will take place at the cellular level. So with the basis of this, many non-specific cell toxicity tests have been developed, okay? So which are replacing the animals which are utilized in the acute toxicity test. We have seen so many methods by which this acute toxicity test, that is LD50 determination, is done, okay, wherein so many animals might die. Okay, so to avoid that, we can utilize the cell lines to carry out such kind of toxicity studies, because ultimately it's the cells which are getting affected. Okay, why not replace the animals with the cell lines? Okay, so here normal human keratinocytes, NHK, or certain other standardized cell lines may also be utilized. Okay, even you can study the metabolic component also. Okay, so metabolic studies may also be done by utilizing the human microsomal enzymes. Okay, so in vitro studies are possible. Okay, toxicity studies, acute toxicity studies, as well as metabolic studies are also possible. And in addition to this, even certain computer softwares are also available now for predicting certain acute toxicity of a particular chemical based upon its chemical structure. So this is also possible now. Several softwares are getting developed for predicting such kind of toxicity of a particular chemical. So this will in turn rule out the utilization of large number of animals. Okay. Next alternative is for the repeated dose toxicity test. Okay, so here the absorption, distribution, metabolism, and elimination of a particular chemical when it is introduced in a particular biological system, these are determined by the nature and degree of the toxicity which may actually be produced by that particular chemical. Now, all these studies can be carried out with the help of certain softwares. Okay, so certain softwares will again aid you in predicting all these properties. Okay, so nowadays a lot of computerized biokinetic modeling is available to predict the distribution of your chemical in the body. Okay, so how it can predict how exactly your and where exactly your drug will get distributed. Among which organs or which tissues of the body, even the extension targeting for the organ specific toxicity, like certain drugs may get accumulated, certain chemicals may get accumulated in the vital organs. So certain targeted toxicity studies can also be carried out. So for example, brain, liver or kidney toxicity studies can also be carried out. Such kind of predictions can be verified quantitatively. Okay, so by utilizing certain cell cultures, okay, of the specialized tissues, like supposing from the software you come to know that this particular chemical, it has a potential to cause damage to the brain cells. So you can utilize the cell lines or cell cultures from this particular organs. Okay, so this will help in replacing the repeated dose study in the animal. So it will help in minimization of the animals. Okay, so with the combined use of computerized biokinetic modeling and organ specific in vitro assays, you will be able to reduce the number of animals and reduce the exposure to the animals. Then the next alternative test is the developmental neurotoxicity test. Okay, so here the basic idea behind this particular test is to reduce the cost and the number of animals, also to facilitate a large number of chemicals. Okay, so there are certain data which can be obtained, okay, for this particular type of testing. Say for example, alternative species can be utilized, or in vitro cell culture models can be utilized, or even in silico models are also available, like computerized studies can also be done to predict the neurotoxicity of a particular substance. Okay, so in these in vitro models, okay, usually the key events of the brain development in a particular species, okay, such as the cell proliferation, migration, differentiation, survival, apoptosis, okay, synaptogenesis, myelination, and axonal and dendritic outgrowth, all these can be studied in this particular in vitro models, okay, for neurotoxicity. Okay, and a good in vitro test, it can even ensure the specificity, sensitivity, reliability, accuracy, and even the predictivity about the toxicity in the human beings. Okay, now what are the common sources of the tissue for various in vitro models? Say for example, there are several sources from which these tissues can be obtained. Okay, that is avian source, chick embryos are available for carrying out the studies, developmental damage studies, or rodents, say for example rats and mice. So from these embryonic or postnatal or adult cell lines can be obtained. Then human beings could also be the source of these tissues. Say neural progenitor cells from the aborted fetuses. Okay, so in certain cases where abortions are carried out, okay, so the fetus can be utilized, the cell lines can be utilized to carry out certain developmental studies. Or the stem cell lines or cord blood derived stem cells can also be the source of these tissues. Then the type of in vitro system cell cultures, which are the types of cells which can be obtained. Either you can obtain the specialized cell lines, okay, which will predict a particular type of tissue, or which will represent a particular type of condition, or a type of cell, or a type of organ. Or certain primary cultures are also utilized, or certain cultures with heterogeneous cell interactions can also be utilized for the in vitro studies. Now what are the advantages and disadvantages of these in vitro studies? Okay, so coming to the advantages, here a small quantity of the test substance is needed as compared to the large amount which is required to be administered to the animals. Then the experiment can be carried out under controlled condition when it is done in vitro. Results also are obtained very quickly. No major infrastructure is required to carry out these studies. But there are certain disadvantages of these in vitro studies also. Like for example, in vivo dose response relationship cannot be obtained from these in vitro study. Or systemic effects can also not be predicted, or certain organ specificity sometimes may lack in these particular types of tests. Okay, then chronic or long-term effects cannot be studied in vitro. Transportation of these cell lines, that is also quite difficult. It has to be transported under specified conditions. So these are some of the disadvantages of the in vitro studies. Now the predictivity, how you will ensure the enhanced predictivity of that particular substance under investigation for human use. Okay, first of all, you should use human based in vitro experimental systems. Okay, so this will give you the human specific data. So as far as possible, humanized cell lines can be utilized for this. Okay, or use the relevant non-human in vivo models. Okay, so which will give you sufficient data on the in vivo parameters. Or sometimes combination of in vitro and in vivo observations will also help in enhancing the predictivity of the human usage of that particular drug or that particular chemical. So it will help in ensuring the safety of that particular chemical. Okay, so these are the several alternatives to the in vivo studies, to carry out the toxicity studies. So this is the reference, M.N. Ghosh, Fundamentals of Experimental Pharmacology. Thank you for watching.